Talking Boxing with Billy C. It began as a podcast, went live on the net, and transformed into a full-blown empire across the web, on Fight Now TV, and on radio stations around the world. It's the only daily boxing talk radio show on the planet, hosted by the only guy with the balls to do it. Many have stepped into the ring. Many have tried to take the belt. And one by one, they've fallen. Another victim of the undisputed heavyweight champion of boxing talk radio. Talkin' Boxing with Billy C is on now.
My style is impetuous, my defense is impregnable, and I'm just ferocious. I want your heart.
And we're coming to you live from the Billy C studio in Lake George, New York. I'm Bill Kelleher, and it's time for Talking Boxing with Billy C. Good morning, good day, good evening. Whenever you're listening, I hope you're doing all right. We got a busy show scheduled for today, busy show scheduled for next week, all kinds of stuff going on the week after. Damn! The show's being brought to you in part by Campanero and Tomkovich. If you're looking for a lawyer, are you? Use the ones to keep my ass out of trouble. That's Campanero and Tomkovich. Give them a call today, 845-221-4099. 845-221-4099. Let Campanero and Tomkovich knock out your legal problem. The show's also being brought to you in part by my friends down at the Halftime Bar and Grill, Route 9, South Glens Falls. Check them out only if you like cool people to hang out with, drink specials on all the time, live entertainment on Friday and Saturday nights, and fantastic food to stuff your face with. If you like any or all of those, then you're going to love the Halftime Bar and Grill. Give them a call right now for directions or reservations. 518-792-4869. 518-792-4869. apologize to the live viewers, or at least the ones that are trying to get online to watch. We do have the new stream. The good news is we do have the new stream. It's programmed. It's ready to roll. System is set up. The bad news is we're waiting for a little guidance from my main man, Andre, who does a lot of the stuff behind the scenes. There's one little glitch. I messed up, man. I need to call my man to help me out, bail me out. My man Andre bails my ass out all the time. So it will be up and running on Monday. I'm confident. We can't stand this Ustream stream anymore. They were the best, but they really have fallen off the cliff. So we're abandoning them, and officially we'll be off beginning Monday. So, Marty Mulcahy scheduled to join us in a little bit. We got some fight results next week, man. Make sure you tune in. I got an interesting interview scheduled for Alexandra. I'm sorry, I know I'm going to mess up. Alexandra Boyd. Now, she's the writer and producer and bigwig for the movie I've been telling you guys about. If you go to our website, www.BillyCBoxing.com, on the right-hand side, you'll see a fight poster-style banner that says Wilderness Project. Click it, and you'll find out all about it. Basically, what it is it's a movie, a story about a British boxer who was an Olympian. And it's tied in with World War One, and it's got a little love story in there, but it's all the backdrop is all boxing. And it's right out of London, man, so you got to check it out. She is going to be a guest on the show on Tuesday, so make sure you tune in. I got to be honest, I got a crush on this chick, so we'll see if I fumble and stumble and bumble when I give her a call. But we will be doing the interview live from England, from London. So we'll be looking forward to that. And by the way, if you want to get involved with that movie, you can get your name in the credits, and you can get some memorabilia from the movie and stuff as they start filming by getting involved with that Kickstart program. And it's a donation type of a thing, whether you donate $10 or $20 or whatever. You don't have to. You can donate a lot more and be a bigger part of the movie, but they're looking for people, even just small donations. Check it out. Go to the website, www.BillyCBoxing.com, and click on the banner. Give a shout-out to my man, Chatty Factory. He's in the chat room right now. And Chatty, like I just said, the live stream may crap out. We will. We do have it all corrected. We just can't wait. We just have to wait to launch it until Monday, so. Did I say that right? We're forced to wait until Monday to launch it. Yes, that is it. We have the poll question up on BillyCBoxing.com, and it's about the transgender situation in combat sports. Now, obviously, it hasn't happened yet in boxing, but it is going to be happening in MMA sometime next month, early next month. And the poll question was, do you think it's unfair for a transgender to compete in combat sports as their new sex, right? You know, so you're a woman, you turn into a man, now you're competing in men's division, or vice versa. You're a man, you turn yourself into a woman, and now you're competing in the women's divisions. Is it fair? You know, it's extremely close. You guys think it's extremely close. Right now, I just put the poll question up yesterday, so I don't know how many actual people have responded yet, but as of this moment, it's 60-40 in favor of, yes, it's unfair, but I'm even surprised that 40%, 6 out of 10 people, 4 out of 10 people are saying that it's not unfair. Now, this is not an issue of, in my opinion anyway, this isn't an issue of, should we treat, transgenders any differently? And I don't, don't get me wrong, I don't. I'm just thinking, in my mind, my vote went to yes, that it's unfair, only because, regardless of the genital reassignment and regardless of all the, drugs that are taken, for the, hormones and stuff like that. Regardless of all of that, I mean, the makeup in this case is still a man, you know, and you know, they're fighting against a woman, you know. So, in my opinion, it seems unfair. But maybe I'm just old fashioned. You know, I don't know. Like I said, man, you know, I've seen pictures of some of these newly invented women, and I would never know the difference, never, which is kind of dangerous, right? Anyway, we got a couple of emails to read. First one, my man Given Quality says his official prediction on the fight this weekend, the big fight. Between Austin Trout and Saul Canelo Alvarez. He says, I'm taking Trout by a knockout and hedging Trout if it goes by decision. He says, I'm thinking it's going to be action-packed, too, a little action, too, he says. I hope you're right, man. And speaking of picks, today, when I break down the fights, I'm not going to be able to break them down as fully as we usually do. I guess there's a problem with BoxRec, man. I don't know about you guys, but I can't seem to get on the damn thing. I started to yesterday. I printed out a couple of records of the guys for my review, and all of a sudden it stopped, and I haven't been able to get on since. Now, I know they're doing some updates over there. So that could be it. So I'm not going to be able to give you some of the statistics that I normally do based on information I pull from there. I will give breakdowns and my picks of the fights and why. But as far as where their ranking is by the computer and the amount of knockouts and specific fighters of, you know, who they won and all that stuff, I'm only going to be able to give a couple on those. So I apologize for that in advance. And the man, anyway, is coming on in a little bit, Marty Mulcahy. But first, we're going to take a short break. We'll be right back.
If you're in upstate New York and you need a trucking company, then you need Roselli Enterprises. Roselli Enterprises is trucking at its finest. They have it all. Dump trucks, dump trailers, walk-in floors, flatbeds, flow boys, tankers, loaders, and a full line of roll-off containers for any job, big or small. Roselli Enterprises is also the source for all your sand, gravel, and topsoil needs. Visit them on the web at RoselliTrucking.com or call 315-433-5115. That's 315-433-5115 and tell them Billy C sent you.
Are you ready, America? Then let's get it on with Fight Now TV. It's time, fight fans. Your channel has arrived. All the fights, all the names, all the action. From world-class boxing events to mixed martial arts showdowns and other combat sports matchups, Fight Now TV delivers the hits and more. Call your television provider and tell them you want to get it on with Fight Now TV. For more details, go to fightnow.com.
We've got a great matchup tonight. Fighting out of the left corner is the number one ranked contender.
No, he is not.
I'm sorry, but who are you?
I am the IBO computer. I am programmed to provide only fair and unbiased boxing rankings. This fighter is the number 15 ranked contender.
Fair and unbiased boxing rankings? That's a new concept.
Actually, it is not. The IBO has provided unbiased computerized rankings for many years.
Well, we've still got a great fight tonight, folks. In the left corner is the number 15 ranked contender.
The IBO, the champion of integrity. Learn more at IBOboxing.com.
Check out BillyCBoxing.com now, or feel the wrath of the mighty mustache.
Oh, that hurts. Why are you doing that to my face? I hate you. I hate you.
That's BillyCBoxing.com. Consider this your warning.
As a young boy, all Billy C dreamed about was one day having his own catchphrase.
And we're back. And we're back.
One boy, one dream, one day, everyone will say.
And we're back. 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 And we're back.
Catchphrase, coming soon to a theater near you.
And
We're back.
You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C. Show. You're watching a replay, man, on LDL TV. And if you're listening to us crystal clear, it means you're a premium podcast subscriber. Glad you could join us. Got some happenings going on the week of the Mayweather-Guerrero fight. Beginning Monday, April 29th, we will be doing a special on Billy C's fight week for Mayweather and Guerrero. Every day, Monday through Friday, at 1 p.m. Eastern Time, we're going to broadcast live some special stuff just focusing on the Mayweather-Guerrero fight. We're going to open up the phone lines. We're going to take emails. We're going to have special interviews. Tony Treen will be in Las Vegas giving us some updates on a daily basis. In addition to that, on Saturday night, immediately following the fight, you can also check out our post-fight show, where we'll have ringside people as well as some other guests, phone lines open, all that happy stuff taking place on Saturday immediately following the show. So check it all out right here on BillyCBoxing.com. And all of those shows will be posted up on YouTube. So if you don't catch it live at 1 p.m. Eastern, you will be able to watch it whenever you want. And speaking of 1 p.m. Eastern, we got the Talk to Me Man show. We missed it last week because we were in Florida, but Monday, this coming Monday, and this week because we weren't prepared for it. But we're coming back Monday, this upcoming Monday, not tomorrow, not the next day, but the day after. Talk to Me Man will be back, and we'll be broadcasting live on BillyCBoxing.com. So check it out, 1 p.m. Eastern. Phone lines will be open. That show is driven by you, the boxing fan. So check it out, 1 p.m. Eastern on Mondays. The Billy C's Talk to Me Man. If you're tuning in live, make sure you check out the chat room at www.billycboxing.com. Go into the chat room and chat with some other boxing fans. We got the emails that were going. Marty Mulcahy will be here at the top of the hour. Given Quality says, Bill, if Floyd Mayweather chose Alvarado instead of the Ghost, what would you have been saying? Wouldn't you have said he was ducking the Ghost, since you titled the show Floyd Mayweather Doesn't Have the Balls to Fight the Ghost? Unbelievable guy. Unbeatable guy is Rios. WTF, what are you saying? Remember a Brielle fight? How is Alvarado a more meaningful fighter versus the Ghost? Please explain. Who is more sophisticated and who is more complete fighter in your opinion? Did I say that yesterday? You definitely interpreted it wrong. I think we were talking about, first of all, as far as Floyd Mayweather is concerned, I like him fighting the Ghost. I said it from day one, and as far as the titling of the shows, I don't personally title them, but yes, I agree with that. Listen, Mike Alvarado had a great fight with Bam Bam Rios, both of them, but I didn't want to see him fight Floyd. I never said that. All right, I think you misinterpreted what we were saying. I believe we were talking about Mike Alvarado fighting Manny Pacquiao, and I thought that it was a better fight for Manny Pacquiao, showing that Manny Pacquiao is constantly taking the tougher fights. Had nothing to do with Floyd. Now, if you're going to, if I was alluding to and had a backdrop of Floyd taking easier fights, I wasn't referring to the Ghost fight. I'm one of these guys that believe that Robert the Ghost Guerrero is going to give Floyd a tougher fight than you Floyd Mayweather fans believe. So, no, I wasn't saying that. But overall, I think when you look at the last several fights, last 10 fights or whatever, by both fighters, Manny Pacquiao and Floyd, I believe, and that's just my opinion, that Manny Pacquiao has fought the tougher opposition than Floyd has. You know, for all things considering, I do. You know, at the times when they fought and everything else. So that's just my opinion. But don't for a minute think that I believe that Floyd should be fighting Mike Alvarado instead of the Ghost. I think the Ghost is definitely the fight for Floyd right now. As far as unbeatable guy, I didn't mean that Rios was unbeatable because he was so great. I meant that he was unbeaten. And, you know, you had to really beat him. I was surprised that they gave Alvarado the decision. Not that I don't think it was justified, because I think Alvarado won. But, you know, based on exactly the point that you're making on the Richard Abreu fight, you know, it seemed like it was going to be hard to beat Rios unless you knocked him out. So I think you totally misunderstood what we were talking about yesterday. As far as who's more accomplished and who is more a complete fighter, in your opinion, are you talking about the Ghost and Alvarado? You know, because if you're talking about the Ghost and Alvarado, I think the Ghost is more accomplished and he's more complete. If you're talking about Floyd Mayweather and either one of those two, of course it's Floyd Mayweather. You know, so I'm not quite understanding, but I think I might have covered all bases there. Finally, Given Quality says, do you think Pacquiao will go back to regular HBO fight if the fight in China, since it would be 11 a.m. start time? You know, that's a good question. I'm not sure. It's all about the money. You know, Manny Pacquiao doesn't want to fight in the United States because of the tax situation. And he certainly is boycotting Las Vegas because of... Bob Arum and Top Rank apparently are boycotting fights in Las Vegas, at least for now. So, you know, where does that leave them? Texas, you know, sorry, just dropped my throat lozenger to keep my throat, so I'm not talking like this by the end of the show. But anyway, it's a good point. You know, regular old HBO pay-per-view, I don't know, maybe they do a delay. I don't know. I personally wouldn't mind seeing her at 11 a.m., man. That's cool. You know, I don't care, man. Hey, my hours are so crazy anyway. You know, that me, personally, I would love it, you know, but that's me. We got one more email that I'm going to read. Then we're going to go to Marty. Then we got several other emails to read when Marty's done. But C.L. Brown says, I do not underestimate Trout by any stretch of the imagination, but if you were a betting person, put your money on Canelo, a.k.a. Red. I don't have a clue as to why anyone would be sleeping on the gut hunger of the fire engine Red. Canelo, a.k.a. Red, is new to America, so we just are now hearing about him, but he's well under the radar. Well, I'm sorry, he says, but he is well underway and hungry as hell in a real way. He may not be as seasoned as he will be over the time due to his youth, but he is definitely en route. Well, C.L. Brown, thanks for the email. And I agree with you. The most of the people that watch or listen to our show on Fight Now TV or on YouTube or on the radio dial or on a premium podcast subscription or any place else they get it, you know, I think most of us know about Canelo because this show, the basis of this show is boxing only, so it kind of attracts boxing people. But you're 100% correct. The masses, the, you know, normal sports fan, the casual sports fan who follows only the big fights may not know who Canelo Alvarez is. So I agree with you there. And this is a great opportunity for him to bust onto the scene. Now, as far as being hungry and all that, I also agree with that. And I agree that he's a talented fighter. I'm not sure that he's going to come out on top. I'm using this fight as a huge gauge. And I was talking to Tony Treem yesterday, and Tony just feels that Austin Trout doesn't have the power to knock out Canelo. And therefore, we all kind of agree that Canelo is going to most likely get the nod. I have some quotes that really upset me by the powers that be about Canelo, which has me believing more reasons that Trout kind of needs to knock out Canelo or at least drop him a couple of times. And if Tony's correct, if he doesn't have the pop to do that, then I'm not so sure. You know, I look at it this way with that fight. C.L. Brown, I look at Cotto, and I say to myself, you know, Trout beat Cotto. How would Cotto have done against Canelo? Now, it didn't happen, so we don't know. But, you know, I thought Cotto was going to give him a tough fight. But here's the thing. You know, Canelo likes guys to stand in front of him. As a matter of fact, he positions himself to stand right in front of his opponent. And he likes to wail away. If you let him do that, he's going to beat you. Cotto may have let him do that. You know, Cotto isn't exactly fleet of foot. However, Trout does have some footwork. He can move around. He can box. You know, the discipline is the part that I wonder about Trout. Is he going to try too hard? Is he going to be, you know, content with without boxing Canelo? I don't know. It is a pick'em fight. I guess if you look at it that way, you know, the odds are that Canelo's going to win. But I'm not so sure that that's where my pick is going to be. But I appreciate the email, CL Brown. Keep it up. We love to hear from all the listeners and viewers. It's what the show is about, so we appreciate that. Speaking of the show, right now I'm going to take a break. We're scheduled to get Marty Mulcahy on the phone. We'll get his thoughts on the Rigondeaux fight from last week, and also the Mamajanov fight, which was another upset. We'll get his thoughts on that, as well as the fight that we were doing, the Sal Cinicola. And if you missed that fight, if you haven't seen Sal Cinicola, it's up on our YouTube page, www.youtube.com/BillyCBoxing. You can also get to it very simply by visiting our website, BillyCBoxing.com, and go to the YouTube page link that we have, which is on the right-hand side. Hopefully you got your homepage set for BillyCBoxing.com. If you missed a fight, it's worth the watch, that's for sure. Sal Cinicola not only put on a great performance at the Peck Center in Fernandina Beach, Florida, not California. But he also broke and set some records. The longest comeback from 25 years. He was in retirement, came back. That broke not only a boxing record, but a Guinness Book of World Records. So check out that fight. Visit our site, www.billycboxing.com. And on the right-hand side menu, you'll see an option that says Billy C YouTube page. Check that out. And while you're there, cast your vote. Is transgender in combat sports, is that fair? Is it unfair? What's your thoughts? Hey, Marty Mulcahy is scheduled to come up next. We'll be right back.
Are you ready, America? Then let's get it on with Fight Now TV. It's time, fight fans. Your channel has arrived. All the fights. All the names, all the action, from world-class boxing events to mixed martial arts showdowns and other combat sports matchups, Fight Now TV delivers the hits and more. Call your television provider and tell them you want to get it on with Fight Now TV. For more details, go to fightnow.com.
Broadcasting in all corners of the globe, on the web and radio.
He would scoff at a stretcher, that man, I would think.
You're listening to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. From upstate New York in the good old U.S. of A.
Boxing is here to stay because we are here to stay.
The best 2 hours of boxing talk on the airwaves.
Hey, fight fans, check out KOFantasyBoxing.com. KO Fantasy Boxing is boxing's only trademarked fantasy game. Check it out, www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. Select your own gym, your own fighters, track them through a season that can last from 3 months to a year, depending upon which league you join. You got to check this out, man. www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. Join it today. Again, www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. And tell them Billy C sent ya.
Test 1, 2. My fellow Americans, good evening. Welcome back to Talking Boxing with Billy C. It's great to be here discussing the sweet science with everybody. I love boxing. I love talking boxing. That's what I do.
Bill.
Wait, what? Why are you interrupting me?
Wrong.
What's
wrong,
the problem?
Billy
what?
C.
I did not have...
We're going to have to ask
wrong
you
speech. What do you mean wrong, Billy C? What's going on here? Fine, I'll go. I just wanted to talk some boxing on TPSradio.net. That's all I wanted to do. I don't need your damn show. I'll get my own talking wrestling with the other Billy C. Yeah, that sounds good. Yeah. I've always been a Hulkamaniac anyway.
Broadcasting live, brother. Welcome back to Talking Boxing with Billy C on the mighty TPSradio.net, brother. What you gonna do, brother?
And we're back. You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C show. You're watching us on the Fight Now television channel. Glad you could join us. All information about Fight Now can be found at their website, www.fightnow.com. Speaking of now, joining us, the man, the myth, the legend himself, Marty Mulcahy. What's up, brother?
Hey, doing good. Myth is right. Since I missed the last couple of weeks, people might think I don't exist.
Oh, come on now. Come on now. That was my fault last week, and the week before, some Easter Bunny, I think it was his fault, right?
Yeah, I had some bad eggs. I had the wrong eggs on that weekend.
Well, I tell you, we lost all of our live stream. Right now, we got the only way people are watching us live right now is on the Fight Now television channel. The stream, which has been awful lately, that company Ustream has really crapped out. Man, they were the top notch. Now they've really sunk to a low. But we got a new stream, and it's really good. We did all last week in Florida. We tested it. And we're going to be launching it on Monday, so we're looking forward to that. So I figured I'd give a quick plug for that. But Rigondeaux against Nonito Donaire, were you surprised a little bit, or what's your thoughts on the fight?
Surprised that it was one-sided, yes. Surprised that Rigo won? No, not really. I thought he'd win the fight because I've seen Nonito Donaire get frustrated in fights before where he wanted the other boxer to, you know, bow to his demands without applying the pressure to do so, and that's what he tried with Rigo. He just did not throw enough punches. We saw in a couple rounds, I think round five, especially, where if he stayed on top of Rigo and threw that extra punch, that third, fourth, fifth punch, after he missed the first two, he could connect, and he knocked him down. But the thing was, there was no consistency behind it. And the other thing with Rigondeaux is the guy, it looks like he was just born in a ring. Like that's where he's most comfortable. You go back to like Marco Antonio Guerra, you know, back in his prime in the mid-90s, and when he was, you know, he had that poker face. I say Rigondeaux has a poker body. It never changes. It's always the same. It's tightly coiled. It's ready to hit you with that counterpunch. And it just, it's like, never changes expression. It's just a force. It doesn't look like you can overcome it when you're inside there with it. And every time Nonito Donaire threw a punch, he got countered. He got countered intelligently. And he was out-thought in there and just couldn't do anything. I think frustration did take over, and you saw that, especially in the first 5 to 6 rounds, where I think he expected things to go his way a little bit more. You know, before, everybody thought if Nonito Donaire was going to get him, he was going to jump on top of him quick and establish his rhythm, establish his presence. That never happened. Rigondeaux never allowed that to happen. So this is all Rigondeaux. And I think his style, I don't think it's appreciated as much as it should be. It's a quick countering style. He's never that far out of range. He has to stay within range because he's a short guy. He can't, you know, he can't outbox you from the outside. He has to do it from his own distance. So it's a difficult style to master, and I think he's done it. And everybody talks about Nonito Donaire, you know, he's the guy coming in. You know, he's the exciting one. If you look back at the records, granted, he's only had 11 fights, but he has a higher KO percentage than Nonito Donaire has, and also he goes to the body, I think, incredibly well. I think that's a lot of the stuff that prevents boxers from coming at him, the way he throws those body shots. They are debilitating, and when they land, and, you know, they're not appreciated as much on TV, I think when you actually go see a fight, body punches, you can tell the impact of body punches much more than you can on television. So just all in all, a superb schooling that Rigondeaux put on Donaire. And the excuses afterwards. You know, I thought he was doing well in that interview until he brought up the excuses, and that pretty much just erased any positives he had from that fight.
You know, I don't want to use the word exposed, but in a way, Donaire was exposed in a sense that he maybe is one-dimensional, like you said, you know, and he has done that in the past. Navarrete, Omar Navarrete's fight comes into mind where, you know, yeah, he couldn't just change the pace. Like, he's a follower, and if you make a mistake, he capitalizes, which is great. But what happens when you face a guy like Rigondeaux, who is an expert at the same thing, and then yet he drove the bus, you know, Rigondeaux. The thing that bothered me was that, you know, he's a guy that is making these excuses and he's like a spoiled kid is what he is, you know, and
very good point.
Yeah, you know, and it kind of, you know, I thought he was put in his place. As far as the excitement level, you know, people are saying that it wasn't exciting and it was a boring fight. I disagree. Floyd Mayweather is known for his defensive prowess and everything else. And when you get into the conversations and I say he's in a boring fight, with the exception of his last two, you know, people are so quick to say, well, it's the sweet science and it's you hit and not get hit and blah, blah, blah. Well, Rigondeaux displayed that and then some. You know, what I was impressed with him, Marty, and I've been talking about it all week, was the fact that Floyd might use his shoulder roll or he might get his head out of the way and an opponent may land slightly or graze him or just miss. But Rigondeaux not only was doing that, he had head movement, upper body movement from his waist up. He was able to pivot to his right or his left, on his right or his left foot, and then be in position to throw punches. To me, that was exciting to see him there and then land two and three punch combinations and get out of harm's way. I mean, all within a second or two. What's your thoughts?
Yeah, no, that's a very good point. You never know what direction Rigondeaux is going to go. It's like, what can you compare it to? You ever seen one of those, you remember as a kid you used to play with those super balls that just you throw them against the wall, you never know how they bounce?
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
Almost like going into a square room, throwing it as hard as you can, and just it bounces all over the place. You can't track it, and that's with Rigondeaux. You can't track him. You never know what direction he's going to pivot. And the other thing is, if you look at Rigondeaux, he's not traditionally fast like Nonito Donaire. He's quick. It's just all like one quick punch and out, one quick punch or one quick movement and out. It's never, you never see him, take three steps in the same direction at one time, basically. He's always just keeping his opponent off balance, and it's done beautifully. There's intelligence behind it. It's not just movement for the sake of movement like you see with some boxers. He does everything for a reason. He's in, along with Roy Jones Jr., he's one of those guys I saw in the amateur, and I said, if he turns pro tomorrow, he can beat a champion. He's a prodigy, is what he is, and I just wish we could have seen him, you know, at 25, 26, you know, in the pros.
Yeah, no, he's a guy that I wish a lot of people would appreciate his style, and I think some of his performances prior to the Donaire fight, you know, maybe the guy got bored in there, you know, I mean, literally,
that's,
I mean,
that's
he does,
what
you
I was
know.
Bringing up, yes.
Yeah, so, and one other thing I found really weird, I've been talking about this all week, and obviously, I like to point out anything when the New York State Athletic Commission gets egg on their face, and I feel that they did have egg on their face in that fight, because in the 12th round, you know, it was obvious that something hurt Donaire's eye, and he put the glove up to his eye in a really weird way. Now, you know, I don't know, I never heard anything about it again. And the announcing team was speculating that maybe he was seeing double, maybe his eye was tearing, maybe he couldn't see out of it. Whatever the case was, he clearly was protecting that eye. And I said to myself, why isn't the ringside doctor or the referee ordering a doctor to inspect the eye? I mean, as it turned out, obviously he was okay, and he did look like he was able to see out of that eye after the fight. But, you know, in a sense, the commission is there to protect the fighter, and in a sense, it was a cry from Donaire that, you know, something wasn't right. He wasn't able to protect himself 100%. I mean, you're taking away that glove, and you're protecting your eye. Now you're virtually fighting with one hand against a sharpshooter, which incidentally didn't really take advantage of it. Some people feel he just let off the gas pedal to carry him that round. But I thought the commission should have had the doctor take a look. What do you think?
I tweeted the exact same thing. If you go back and look at my tweets on that fight, I said, you know, where's the doctor? Why is the referee not taking me to the corner to have a doctor take a look at it? You know, if he would have been limping all of a sudden, that would have been noticeable. And you're right, it was noticeable enough for everyone to see it. You didn't have to have a high-definition TV to see that he was protecting that eye and that something was wrong. We are so used to seeing these boxers take the punishment that when a boxer feels something's wrong, you can see it. He has that instinctive reflex to, you know, almost like after a headbutt, where he backs up right away to, you know, kind of clear his head and to put his his glove to wherever he thinks the cut may be to look and see if there's a cut. And that was the exact same instance there. And for 30 seconds, he was, you know, carrying that glove high, and you could tell something was wrong. And I think for the first 10 seconds, Wiggendow did kind of jump on it. And then even he noticed, you know, this is out of the ordinary. He saw him back up. So maybe a little bit of humanity there, but I'm pretty sure if he would have been behind in the fight, he would have been pressing it more.
You know, the other thing, too, is the referee had broken them up. They had went into a clinch at one point. And then as soon as they broke him up, his glove went up there like it was a magnet. Bam, you know, protecting that eye again. So, yeah, it was strange.
Now the sad part is, you know, where does Wiggendow go from here? You know, Abner Meres would be the fight, would be the really good fight. But, you know, he's a golden boy fighter, so that's not going to get done. It is kind of, you know, sad that after the biggest fight of his career, you know, here's a letdown. It's not going to go in a progression, you know, to get bigger and bigger. And he doesn't have that much time left. You know, he does get up there in age. He has a type of style where I think he can last 3 more years, you know, in fighting against the elite. But I just wanted to see him go up against somebody really elite, you know. And you think maybe move up, face Mickey Garcia. But once again, you know, it's really frustrating to see. He's not going to have that next fight to push him into superstardom.
You know, I can't stand all the excuses that Donaire had, but the worst one of all, I mean, yeah, we heard about the baby. Yeah, we heard that he was forced to get his training over the phone, which is totally absurd. But the worst one I heard was he says, oh, the weight's no good for me. I'm going to move up in weight. I mean, how do you justify that? You know, I mean, the guy clearly does not have the knockout power that he had at the lower weights, and he's just constantly moving up. You know, I don't know, man. I think that he's basically, like I said, a spoiled kid, and it's not refreshing, that's for sure.
And I think he knows that he will, that style, he was not going to be able to defeat Wiggendow. So basically, loser leaves the division is what it comes down to.
Yeah, well, maybe Wiggendow should follow him and get the fight again in the next one. Hey,
he got paid like $500,000 less, so I don't see why not.
Two quick questions on fights that took place last week. Mamajanov knocks out Angelo Santana. It was kind of shocking, but the thing was, Santana, midway through, before it was stopped, I mean, those body shots is what broke Santana down. I give him credit for getting back up and continuing, but he was a done fighter. What's your quick thoughts on that fight?
No plan B. That's my first thought. You know, when the KO didn't come, that's the thing you always worry about with knockout punches. When the knockout doesn't come and they fall behind, when the pressure isn't doing it for them, can they go to a plan B? Do they have the intelligence to do that? Do they have the background? Do they have the trainers? Have they been taught to do that? You know, sometimes these guys, their entire lives, they just steamroll against the opposition. And when the opponent doesn't play along, do they have that secondary skill? And it's just obvious that Angelo Santana doesn't have that secondary skill. And, you know, he's gotten to this level doing that, so I don't know if he can go back to his roots and improve on the other things to become something more than a puncher, you know, somebody like a, you know, somebody who can get to the title shot but is not going to win the title shot because he's just not an all-around boxer. And I'm afraid, you know, and it doesn't just come down to the power. And, you know, outboxing the other guys, all it comes down to footwork, you know, putting yourself in position to throw 3 punches instead of just 1 punch. And you never saw that from Santana. So, and Mamadanov, this is a guy who, you know, as a pro, he's fought much more difficult opposition. And the other thing is the amateur background. You know, he had amateur fights in Europe where you're facing better competition in the USA, unfortunately. So, their European boxers are like one step above our American boxers right now. It's shown in the Olympics, it shows in the international tournament, and now it's showing as the pros when they meet at a similar stage of their career. And you know, Mamadanov, give him all the credit. He did not wilt under the pressure, and that's down to his not only his boxing ability but to his mental toughness. And if he did not prepare 100% in the gym, he wouldn't have won this fight. So all credit to him. I hope he gets another opportunity on Showtime. That's what I like about Showtime, too. I think they're going to bring Angelo Santana back because, you know, if you lose in an exciting fashion, they'll bring you back. So, and that's what I expect him to do, so he'll get a second chance.
Did you catch the Sal Cenicola fight?
Which one?
My guy, Sal Cenicola, 53 years old.
No.
You got to check it out, man. Check it out. Let me know what you think next week.
It's up. The last weekend was all about, I don't even know about that.
Well, check it out. It's up on our YouTube page. He made history, 25 years in retirement, 53 years old, came back. Looked pretty good. Against the opponent he was in there with, but head movement and body attack, I mean, it was old school, man. Check it out when you get a chance. It's only a four-round fight, so it's up under our YouTube page.
I can invest in a four-round fight.
There you go. And I think you'll enjoy it. I think you'll enjoy it. This week we got some great fights to talk about. Number one, Tyson Fury against Steve Cunningham. Not only do I like the matchup, I love the fact it's on in the afternoon. It's gonna be bring back memories when I used to watch big fights on ABC Wide World of Sports. What's your thoughts on this fight, man? Because it really is a tough one to pick.
Yeah, it is, specifically because Tyson Fury. I don't think we're giving enough credit for being an athlete. You know, he doesn't have.
We lost you, Marty. You got to get me back. You got to give us a shout back. Hopefully Marty can hear me, but we'll have to wait and see what's up there. We were talking about the Tyson Fury and Steve Cunningham fight, and hopefully we don't have another system issue here. When we try to get Marty back right now. Good, we got Marty back. Sorry about that, man.
That's no problem at all.
Go ahead. Yeah. What are your thoughts on the Tyson Fury Cunningham fight?
Yeah, I was just saying, I don't think Fury gets enough credit for being a good athlete, on top of being a good boxer. You know, he's 6'9", 245, doesn't have that sculpted body, you know, that we expect, you know, that Adonis type like the Klitschko's. And he gets stuff done. But it's kind of, he does a lot of it with boxing, with footwork. And I think that this fight is going to be a test of his footwork. Because if you look at his previous opponents, like Tyson, Chisora, who else was it? Martin Rogan stood right in front of him, Matt Aloney, those type of boxers, they'll change. They'll stand in front of you. Cunningham isn't like that. He can move. He is a natural cruiserweight. I think he has better reflexes than anybody he's faced up until this point. So, yeah, I think this is a good test. But size, I think even Tyson Fury said it best. You know, it comes down to size. No 200-pound man is going to beat me, is what he said. And I believe him. I think he's going to win on it. A 10-round fight might be a little bit, might be a little bit closer. You know, I think the first three, four rounds is going to be Cunningham. And Tyson Fury is going to have to catch up. He's going to have to make adjustments in the ring. And he did it against Derek Chisora in that fight. He also did it a little bit against Kevin Johnson. You know, he was always ahead in that fight, but you could see him trying out different things, trying his jab, trying the right hook a little bit, and leading with the right hand instead of, flapping out that little, you don't want to call it a slapping jab, but it's not the stiff jab that it should be with a man that size. So he tried stuff in the Kevin Johnson fight, and I think in the Cunningham fight, he needs to do more than try. He needs to make it work, because Cunningham, he's not a shot entity yet, and the only problem with him is he doesn't have the size. Can he stand up to it? And I'm glad this is on NBC Sports, because I think this could be one of those, like, comeback fights, almost like Carl Frosch when he fought against Jermaine Taylor, where he was behind in that fight, and he really had to put on the gas in order to catch up and then score that last-second victory. So I'm hoping it's a fight in that sense. Tyson Fury has the charisma. He's already sold a fight out with his mouth. So I want to see how NBC, plays that angle. You know, are they going to show all of his press conference jives at Cunningham? Are they going to play up his personality? So in a way, Tyson Fury has to live up in two different stages, inside the ring and outside the ring. He has to live up to that persona, and inside the ring, he has to be that destroyer that his size indicates he is.
Interesting point. One of my knocks on Tyson Fury was his jab. He delivered his jab from, like, below his belt line. It came way up, and he's, like you said, he's almost 7 feet tall, 6'9", and when you're fighting a shorter guy at 6'2", which is a monster compared to me, that jab is taking a while before it reaches a fighter. And a guy that's got quick reflexes and a decent counterpuncher like Cunningham could be effective. However, he has seemingly worked on that. He's been working with an American trainer his last couple of fights, and it was a question I asked him in our last interview. And He said he is trying to deliver his jab a little snappier and quicker and straighter. And his body tone has also taken on a different shape. He doesn't look like just that big white guy anymore. You know, he is starting to get some muscle tone. So maybe he is getting better and better. That was something that I was concerned about with Tyson Fury, because for his first, you know, most of his fights until his last handful, he really didn't seem like he was getting better, but now he does. And like you make an interesting point, it's like he's experimenting with different things he's working on in the gym. So I think he has to put it all together to beat Cunningham. I don't think Cunningham is that great anymore, but I think he's a really good test and a gauge for Tyson Fury.
Yeah, it's a test of his feet. It's a test of his intelligence. It's not a test of Fury's power. Or, you know, because I don't think he can be, or even as a boxing ability, to back off his back foot. He's not going to be pressured in that sense. It's about, you know, becoming that well-rounded boxer I was talking about with Wigandow, where he can do anything. At the heavyweight, let's face it, at heavyweight, you do not need to be that great all-around boxer. You know, in order to defeat the Klitschko's, yes, but everybody else, you can have flaws. And like you were talking about that jab, you know, you want that flick at the end. It's almost like he's similar to Larry Holmes in body physique, and also, you know, Larry Holmes had one of the greatest jabs ever, but if you look at it, it was not exactly, you know, the telephone type pole jab of Sonny Liston. It wasn't a stopping force. It was a distracting force. It set things up for him. And with Fury, you want to see a different kind of jab. You want to see the stopping jab, like Vladimir Klitschko has. And you want to see some accuracy to that. And remember, the jab isn't just there to fill a void. It's there to set things up. It's there also as a defensive weapon. So far, we've only seen it in one way with Tyson Fury, you know, more as a range-finding thing than anything else. Once it becomes that weapon where, you know, it stops people in their tracks, or it's used to stop an opponent from coming at him and set up his own arsenal, then, you know, we're going to see. And let's also remember that, you know, Tyson Fury is not even 25 years old yet. You know, he's not matured physically yet, or, for a matter of fact, mentally yet. So he still has a lot more to learn. And everybody's saying, you know, get him the Klitschko's, get him the Klitschko's. I'm saying, no, don't get him the Klitschko's. Give him 2 more years of training. Give him 3 more years of training, and then he'll be ready for an older Klitschko who's on the way down, perhaps. But right now, he's only 24. You know, we're not asking all these lightweights, these welterweights, you know, at the age of 24 to go up there and defeat a solid all-around champion. So why are we asking as a Tyson Fury?
No, you're right. Well, people are just longing for a change at heavyweight. I would like to see him, if he beats Cunningham in a dominating fashion, I'd like to see him fight David Haye. I mean, that would be a good fight. And if he gets by David Haye, I mean, I think he earns a shot, but we'll have to wait and see.
Well, then Cunningham's a great setup for this, because David Haye is, you know, the A version. Cunningham does fight a little bit like David Haye, but he's not as fast and he's not as powerful. So it would be, you know, that level of progression fight where you go from a B fighter to an A fighter of the same type.
The other big fight we'll touch on right now, before we get into some of the other ones, I don't want to run out of town of time, of course, is the Canelo Alvarez against Austin Trout. It's a tough one to pick, man. Incidentally, make sure you get your picks in. Who do you like in this one?
I get my picks, darn it.
Yeah, Austin, don't forget. I think you're ready to get zeros averaged in. I don't know how many you missed, but
I'll shoot it out again. I sent it out yesterday, like at 7:30.
You sent it out?
Yes, I sent it out yesterday at 7:30. I'm positive, because I picked Saul Alvarez begrudgingly in this fight. You know what? When I look at Austin Trout, he's that spoiler. He's not stylistically, but I think he can become this generation's Bernard Hopkins in that he spoils a lot of great fights. You know, he gets in there, he wins, he doesn't do it excitingly, but he's effective in there. And that's the exact same thing that Bernard Hopkins is. He's effective. He gets his game plan. He establishes his game plan. The two things I think that are going against him here is that Alvarez, he stays on top of you. And I think because of his activity, you look at Texas judging, it's been, you know, sporadic at best in the past. They go with favorite. Canelo's obviously going to be the favorite. Every time he comes close to landing a power punch, 40,000 people are going to be cheering for him. I think that can win him, you know, 1 or 2 rounds. And in a close fight, that's all you need is those 1 or 2 swing rounds. Who's it going to go to? Because of his style, I think it's going to favor Alvarez. you know, as far as getting those swing rounds, he's going to be the pressure fighter. He's going to have more volume. And I think people are sleeping on Trout's physicality. Yeah, he think he can absorb some of that punishment. And mentally, he is a very strong fighter. He beat a Miguel Cotto, you know, in New York City in front of that big Puerto Rican crowd. He went down to Mexico twice and won decisions against decent Mexican fighters. So I think he's going to be in his fight mentally the whole time. I think he's going to be there physically the whole time. But can he push Alvarez back enough? Can he, you know, maintain that distance where he works at a distance? That's what the question is. And with Alvarez, he's that young force where his punches kind of, they debilitate you. You know, is he going to be able to kind of like with Tyson Fury, to wear his opponent down physically and then take those championship rounds? I think it's going to be won in the 10th, 11th, and 12th round with Alvarez's forward movement and cutting off the ring. Before those, I think the first 5-6 rounds, you're going to see Alvarez's footwork lacking a little bit, where Trout's going to be on the outside, you know, hitting him with that darting jab and with his accurate punches. And maybe win 3-4 of the first 5 rounds, and then Alvarez, who, you know, we're talking about age, he's a young guy, but he's a smart guy. He's already, you know, at the age of 22, he's already been in 42 fights. That's something you just don't see anymore. Not only, you know, is he learning along the way, but he's also getting the best sparring possible, you know, out in California, where with Austin Trout, you're not seeing that, you know. So these are the little advantages that these elite boxers have over the guys that, like Bernard Hopkins, who have to, you know, work a little bit harder to get to earn their place with the elite because, you know, they don't have that fan base that Canelo has. So I'm picking Alvarez, but it's going to be really tough, and I think it could be controversial at the end, and perhaps even a draw.
Who's the best opponent that Saul Alvarez has beaten, in your opinion, so far?
Shane Mosley was too old, so I think Ryan Rose might be the best one so far. As far as still having all of his skills, as far as name value goes, you know, Shane Mosley's the best one. You know, Jose Zito Lopez was just way too small. Kermit Cintron doesn't have him mentally. Alfonso Gomez didn't have the speed. Yeah, I think if you look at it, his best win was against Ryan Rose. Maybe Matthew Hatton fight as well.
Yeah, well, that's why I think Austin Trout is being underestimated, because this guy is way above that talent level. So we'll see. We'll see on Saturday.
Yeah, he is. Like I said, there's not a ton of confidence behind that pick. But if you look at Austin Trout, you know, Miguel Cotto was kind of made for him. He's a smallish guy. You know, who's his best win after that? Was Delvin Rodriguez and the fight up to that? Yeah, I think his other wins were more notable and more impressive because of where they took place, those two wins in Mexico against David Lopez, who is a really good, you know, a decent fighter, and against, you know, Alvarez's brother, against Rigoberto. So those are quality wins. I don't think he lost any round in there. He wasn't allowed to, basically, because it was happening down in Mexico, and all the close go rounds were going to go towards the Mexican fighter. So outside of the Cotto fight, I mean, I was aware, and a lot of people were aware of Austin Trout because he was a really good amateur, you know, as well. So he has that, you know. He went to, I think it was Andrade who he defeated in one of the national championships that I got to take a look at. But this is a guy who's been on the scene at the amateur level. And like I said, he just had to work his way up in the pro level because he didn't really have that big promotional push.
Nathan Cleverley's going up against Robin Krasniqi, and normally I wouldn't even think this is a tough fight. However, Krasniqi is working with Torsten Kanzmeier, who's a friend of the show's, of course, and he was the guy that actually was responsible for increasing the punching power of Robert Stiglitz, and we also saw what happened to Arthur Abraham after that. Are you giving Krasniqi a chance against Cleverley?
It's a mirror image, is whatever the fight comes down to. These guys are physically and stylistically, they're much the same. Nathan Cleverley throws his punches more, throws more of his punches, and is more of a snap behind the punches. Now, if Kantemeyer can get that done, if he can elevate that power level of Krasniqi, who obviously needs it, I think he doesn't even have a 50% KO ratio. That's good. And that, the other thing that brings is the confidence to throw those big punches. You know, if you don't have the big power, sometimes you say, you know, I'm not going to you know, throw a two-punch combination and finish it with a big right hand. If Torsten Kantemeyer, you know, establish that confidence to go along with the power, then, yeah, then I think he has a better chance, because he's going to need to throw those daring punches, you know, going to the other guy's hometown. So in order to silence the crowd a bit, in order to keep Nathan Cleverly off him. Because, like I said, as far as physically and as far as their style of fight, it is. It's like shadow boxing for these two. They are very similar to each other. But you throw in the hometown advantage. Nathan Cleverly has also fought in the better level of opposition. So he's a little bit, I keep saying this, he's a little bit faster. He's a little bit more powerful. And in boxing, you know, a little is a lot. So, yeah, I'm going with Cleverly on this pick. But you're right. If that confidence is there with the punch, with the added power, he has the intelligence to do it, because Krasniqi is not is no joke as far as his abilities go. It's just that he doesn't have that one extra dimension to make him the champion, I think. Whereas with Cleverly, I think you see that snap to his jab, that pursuit. The guy really goes after people. He tries to make exciting fights. So in a way, I'm hoping for Cleverly, just because I think for that division, it's better if he becomes the champion, the established champion. He already is a champion.
Really quickly, who's going to win, Victor Terrazas or Christian Mahares? It's youth versus age. What do you think?
Yeah, I'm picking Mahares in that fight. He's a southpaw. He's fought the better opposition. And when you look at Terrazas, the fight I remember him most against is against when he went to England against the binman, Wendell Monroe. And he looked good at there up until the sixth, seventh round, and he started to fade a bit. And he tries to stay on top of you, but you see his punches coming. They're kind of winging, and he gets right in front of you. He doesn't work angles really well. And Mahares is a guy who, even at his advanced age and with the amount of fights he has on him, he's slicker, and I think he can avoid those punches. He'll see them coming. And he's just, overall, he's just too mature, I think.
Plus, he's kind of in a... like a second life with his career.
Yeah, he shocked me when he knocked out Rafael Marquez. I thought he could win that fight by decision, but not by stopping.
Yeah, I like him too. I like him too. And another fight that's kind of a tough one is Manuel Larte against Jonathan Batista. I mean, Batista is a fighter that you know, a lot of people are regarding as a good fight, but Larte isn't a bad fighter. I mean, who do you like in that one?
Yeah, see, but the thing is, I haven't seen that much as far as Batista. I know he's getting to play in this as far as reputation wise, but you know, Ghanaian boxers are always tough. I mean, they're a physical bunch. And he's a southpaw on top of it. This Larte, he's a more mature guy. I think he's over 30. So, you know, I'm not expecting him to come in there and you know, be the speedier guy. But if you look at Batista's record, the only thing I did last night was look at his record, you know, because there's not a lot of footage of him out there. He has fought no one. So I think Larte is more established in that sense. And I think in a welterweight fight like this, where I don't really know which one is better as far as skills, I'll take the physical presence over that. And I think Larte has a physical presence here, and I think that he'll establish that. And if Batista, if he's not the physical presence, can he box backing up? And I know, you know, the Dominican Republic has a great amateur program, but these guys just are not breaking out as far as the pro stage is going, you know. So I think Larte would be the pick here, but once again, you don't have enough of a sample size to tell, you know, with any confidence he's going to win it.
No, I agree with you on that one, too. One quick question. Transgenders in combat sports, do you think there's an advantage? Do you think it's fair?
There has to be. It's gay to say it, but the male species is just the physically more dominant. Yes, it is. Our muscles... I think our muscles are more pronounced, and you're just born stronger. Where's this question coming from? That's a good question. But because I've seen what happened on HBO with that female basketball player who was a man before, and you see the advantages there as far as upper body strength and stuff like that. So yeah, I would think, especially upper body strength, that the man would have a much more advantage.
Well, I blindsided you. It's in the news. Transgender, who's a girl now, female now, Fallon Fox is her name. She's an MMA fighter. Now, she's fighting on a big event in a couple of weeks, and she's fighting in the women's division. It's already set and everything else. Now, you know, I've seen pictures of transgender men that changed into women that in a million years I couldn't tell. I mean, they look like centerfold Playboy bunnies. They're so gorgeous, all right? But this particular individual does not look like that. It looks like a man with a wig on, you know, and just like you said, the muscle tone of a man is there and everything else. And I strongly believe that it's a disadvantage for the, in this case, because he went from man to woman, now he's fighting in the woman division. I think it's a disadvantage. Now, I put the poll question up, Marty, and right now it's 60-40. 4 people out of 10 think that there is no disadvantage, you know, so I'm a little surprised.
Well, here's the thing. Remember how I was telling you how I think European amateurs are better than American amateurs, and one of the reasons they are better is because they consistently fight better opposition. So I'm sure this man, if he was a wrestler before, wrestled against much better opposition, so he has much more experience than this female MMA fighter. So not only do I think he has the physical advantage, he also has the experience advantage because he's probably been wrestling against, you know, really good opposition since the age of 8. So, you know, 20 if he went to college wrestling. So he has all that experience behind him. Where do female wrestlers go? You don't have a lot of them. So you can't really train against the best as far as females go. There's a bigger pool of talent to go against. So I think not only does he have a physical advantage, he probably has much more of an advantage in how much he's wrestled during his entire lifetime.
All I know is, man, you hear about these guys using, taking all kinds of things to...
To become a female.
Yeah, that's what I mean. I mean, they really go to great extents and to get an advantage. I mean, we've heard of performance-enhancing drugs, but, geez, I think this is pushing the envelope a little too far.
It's a good, I don't think you call it an ethical question because I think she should be given the right to compete.
Right.
And, no person's going to go through that whole... You know, sex change process simply for the sporting aspect. I mean,
I'm only kidding.
So,
I'm only kidding. I was only kidding about that. I think if somebody did that, that's quite extreme.
That's dedication to the sport, right?
There you go. Hey, Marty, didn't mean to throw that one at you, but I did it to everybody else this week. So, hey, make sure you send them to me again, those picks. I did not get them from you. So I don't know what's going on. That's the second week that's happened. So
we'll do that for sure.
Yeah, definitely do that. And enjoy the fights. We got a real good week this week. And we'll talk to you next week, my man.
And please, everybody tune in to the NBC telecast. Let's get those ratings up so they'll bring it back again.
Sounds good. I know I'm going to. It's at a perfect time for me. It's not way past my bedtime, man.
Yeah, and it's pretty close to happy hour.
There you go. Well, we'll be happy anyway, so.
Hopefully the fight will make everyone happy.
There you go. Well, we'll talk next week, my man.
Yes, sir. And everybody enjoy their weekend.
All right, take care. That's the man, the myth, the legend himself, Marty Mulcahy. I got to take a break. We'll be right back.
Join us here for 2 hours. And Billy and the gang do what they do best.
Every time I start talking about boxing, a white man got to pull Rocky Marciano out there. Rocky Marciano was good, but compared to Joe Louis, Rocky Marciano ain't...
It's Joe Louis's ass.
Joe Louis was 75 years old when he fought.
Huh? What?
We're supposed to be talking boxing.
It's Talking Boxing with Billy C.
As Billy C sits here in the multi-million dollar Talking Boxing studios, sipping a fine wine before you're even out of bed, you should be thinking, damn, I wish I had a mustache like his. It's the Talking Boxing with Billy C show. He's Billy C, and you're not. Sucks to be you.
Now let's dig into our archives and hear a rare interview when Billy C. first became the champion of boxing talk radio. Hello, Billy C. As the new champ, can we ask you a few questions?
Why, certainly.
Okay, your fans would like to know how you and your corner have successfully walloped the competition.
We're not ordinary people. We're morons.
Anything else?
I'm a victim of circumstance.
Did your success finally come when you made the show 5 days a week for 2 hours? What do you think?
I'm trying to think, but nothing happens.
Now, please tell the listeners what you've learned from making it this far.
Certainly. If at first you don't succeed, keep on sucking till you do succeed.
Great words of wisdom, Billy C. Keep up the great work as the undisputed People's Champion with your show, Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. Any last words to anyone who's listening?
This is your fault, you bonehead.
And we're back. You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C show. You're watching us on the Fight Now television channel. All the information about the channel can be found on their website, www.fightnow.com. And speaking of now, we're going to be going back to the emails, and I got some news. I got some fight results that took place in Australia. We got some updates. I got to admit, the best comments that I've ever heard come out of Floyd Mayweather's mouth, I'm actually going to give him some credit in a few minutes, so we got that. We got some denials about an announcement that was made yesterday. We got that coming up. And then, of course, I'm going to break down and give you my predictions of the fights coming up this weekend. A quicker version because there was, at least on my end, something wrong with BoxRec. So I couldn't print out. I usually print out their records so I can discuss some of the fights as we bring them up and stuff. And I was running late and only got a couple before BoxRec system went down. So, Marcus J. Davis says, Gary Russell Jr. will beat Guillermo Rigondeaux easily. And Bob Arum knows this, and that's why that fight will never happen. But Rigondeaux is a great fighter, and he exposed Nonito Donaire. Well, Marcus Davis, I like Gary Russell Jr. I think he's a very talented fighter. He's exciting. You know, he's got hand speed. He appears to have some pop. I know some people disagree with me, but he appears to have some pop. But there is no way in hell he is ready to fight and or beat Guillermo Rigondeaux. I totally disagree with you there. The reason why they don't want to put him in with Guillermo Rigondeaux, first of all, it's not Rigondeaux who doesn't want to put him in with Gary Russell. It's Gary Russell would never. I would be shocked if Team Russell Jr. pursued a fight against Rigondeaux. If they already have, and I'm missing that, and I'm looking like a fool right now, I would say Bob Arum is a jerk if he doesn't sign that fight. That's not a tough fight for Rigondeaux at this point. And don't get me wrong, I love Gary Russell Jr. He's not ready for Rigondeaux. As far as Nonito Donaire being exposed, to a degree, I agree with you 100%. I think Nonito Donaire is a one-dimensional fighter. I think people put him on a pedestal much too quick. I think he's a product of the media, like my man Given Quality referred to him as a media darling, and I agree with that. He's a product of today's champion, a fighter who gets signs up and becomes linked to one of the top two or three promoters that throw their money around. So everybody knows who Nonito Donaire is. And he was protected. He fought, calculated risk opponents where he was able to look bigger and better and stronger and faster and all those things until last Saturday. So in a sense, he was exposed, but he's still a pretty damn good fighter. You know, I'm not saying he's exposed to the point where, you know, see, I told you he's a bum. No. And the same thing would go with Mayweather. If Mayweather loses a fight, you know, whether it's this one or the next one or whatever, that's not going to mean he's exposed. You know, I mean, being exposed means Deontay Wilder has to run in the risk of being exposed. He's fought nobody, and if he fights a real fight and loses, that's a guy who's exposed. You know, David Rodriguez, another undefeated heavyweight out of Texas, 35-0 or something like that. That's a guy that he fights a regular fighter, and you could say he's exposed. You know, but Nonito Donaire, Floyd Mayweather, Manny Pacquiao, all these top upper echelon fighters, they lose a fight, they lose a fight. They weren't the better man that night. The word exposed in Donaire's case is only a little bit, it's a gray area, in my opinion. But thanks for the points. Keep them coming. We love the emails. Marcus Ottavio says, we got back-to-back Marcus. Marcus Ottavio says, chill with the politics, Billy C. If I wanted to hear a middle-aged bald man whine, I'd watch Dr. Phil's prostate exam. Dude, is that called for? You know, first of all, you know, I'm not bald, all right? I'm thinning, yeah. And if I grew my hair a little longer, it would cover up this clear, shining spot on the top of my forehead. My forehead is just growing. It's not that I'm bald, you know? And I think you're being a little harsh on old Billy C. As far as politics, you know, if you're talking about yesterday, yes, I gave the opinion I'm not a big fan of our president. But on the other hand, I thought, you know, he's a little busy right now rather than worrying about pardoning Jack Johnson. But I will fill in the rest of the sentence. Marcus says, just kidding. He says, you make some good points. But in his opinion, it is time to pardon Jack Johnson. Not that it matters, though, other than symbolically, because Jack Johnson is dead as disco, and so are the rednecks who persecuted him. But yes, perhaps a pardon would be a nice gesture, better 100 years later than never. I agree with that. I agree with that. And it's a shame that and that was my point. I wasn't trying to get political yesterday. But my point was that, you know, we were wrong. We, as the United States, were wrong to even think the way we thought. And I say we, even though my ancestors weren't even here. You know, I don't even consider myself white. You know, I'm Italian, and I wasn't here. We had nothing to do with the injustice that was brought upon African Americans. So, and that's what this is about. It's the bottom line is, you know, during Jack Johnson's time, it was only 40 years since the Civil War, and his parents were born slaves, and you know he was born free, of course. But it was a terrible injustice and how they railroaded him, and I agree with all of that. And I'm a huge fan. Jack Johnson is one of my favorite fighters. I love the guy. I love everything about him. I love his balls, you know, that he did what he did and refused to play second fiddle in every aspect of his life. I love it, you know. But I think that the injustice that was done needs to be exposed. I think it's better for us to show that this man, you know, came and survived and raised himself above that BS. You know, what I don't want to see happen is that, during our lifetime, we look at it as, finally getting justification symbolically, just like Marcus says here. And, you know, we feel good about it. But how are they going to look at it 50 years or 100 years from now? It's going to be forgotten. I'm hoping that it does not get forgotten. But my fear is that it would be forgotten that that he went through this, you know, by pardoning him in our, you know, records. At least this is the way I've seen with the United States, and I made the reference of what I went through personally when I wrote my book on Tom Molino, the research I was trying to find on slave fighting, which we know took place. I mean, we know it did, but our government was quick to hide it all. You can't find it. You have to really dig deep and find it in other publications when they make reference to it, like we did. And as far as records of it itself, you know, so and so from this plantation fighting so and so from that plantation, those are all they're all destroyed or hidden, or I don't know, man. You know, but that's all I meant. I just don't want it to be forgotten. I want him to get credit to show how ridiculous the thought process was during that time by Americans. And make no mistake, you're not talking about, you know, just, you know, you make reference to a specific group labeled as redneck or whatever, but it wasn't just them. High prominent people, Jack London, a literary genius, one of the most, you know, recognized writers in the history of penmanship. Is that correct? Alex, where's Alex? In journalism. I mean, this guy was, you know, at the top. You know, you talk about Ernest Hemingway. You talk about Jack London. I mean, you know, a literary genius. And he was writing stuff in newspapers that referred to Jack Johnson with the N-word and everything else, save the white race. I mean, all this stuff, you know, and he was being respected. So it wasn't just, you know, a thought process from specific individuals that, you know, we label today, you know, in a negative way. But this was high-ranking people felt the same way. So, I mean, this is something that is preserved. And I think that Jack Johnson, in my opinion, needs to get credit to be able to, you know, recognize that he was able to accomplish what he did and still stay part, you know, stay straight on the course. And how ridiculous it was for him to finally come back and have to serve his time. He served his time. That's the whole other thing. You know, when you look at that whole picture, I mean, Jack Johnson did nothing wrong. You know, he did nothing wrong, except he was born with a different color skin than was popular at the time. You know, so, I don't know, man. I don't know. I do agree with Marcus. Symbolically, it's great. But I hope that if he does get pardoned, that they make sure that pardon is, you know, put in history as being done symbolically, and that the reason, you know, and the whole basis and the actual law, the Mann Act, doesn't stay defined, because I want that to make sure that future generations see how absurd and ridiculous the thought process in the United States was during Jack Johnson's time. That's just my opinion. Marcus also goes on to say, first-time part-time boxer BJ Flores is apparently set to fight a guy named Nurai Safiri. He's rated number 3 by the WBO, but it's going to be a mandatory eliminator. The winner is set to go against the winner of Marco Huck and Ala Afolobi. He says, I worry about Pacquiao's health now, and he's going to fight a prime younger hard hitter. I don't see Manny winning that fight. Might be his final fight. On a Canelo fight, barroom brawls happen, but who cares? That doesn't hurt his image. He says, even nice guys get angry. You mess around, and you get your jaw busted. You know, he's referring to three things here. First and foremost, BJ Flores. Let's put that one, let's talk about that one right now. BJ Flores, back in a couple of weeks ago, they announced, Francisco Palacios announced that, you know, he was fighting. The date was set. It was May 11th in Germany, and that he and BJ Flores was set to fight for the cruiserweight interim title by the WBA. Now, this is a belt that obviously there would be sanctioning fees, and it would be for a belt. An interim belt is recognized as a title. So he immediately gets a shot at a title. The winner of this fight becomes the interim champion. So it would be Francisco Palacios against BJ Flores. It was to take place on May 11th. Francisco Palacios actually said, you know, made some comments on it. He said, and I quote, this is unbelievable for me. Turn of events in the last six months ago, I was basically done, not fighting. I almost quit this sport. And today I get a contract. I signed a contract to fight BJ Flores for the cruiserweight title. He said, you know, I don't know what happened against Vlad Zarek, but I'm going to show everybody this is me, blah, blah, blah. You know, and once again, BJ Flores proves to us all that he's nothing but a BS artist. Because then a couple weeks ago, and I don't have that press release, and I was trying to find it. I don't even have it on the schedule. But yes, Nuri Sarifi is going up against BJ Flores. This is what Flores says. And the winner gets to fight Marco Huck and Ala Afolobi. The winner of the Huck and Afolobi fight gets to fight the winner of the Flores Nurai Sarifi fight. I agree with Marcus here. What a joke, BJ Flores. Now, obviously, he's taken the easiest route. First of all, it's a joke that Sarifi is even ranked. I too have never seen or heard of him, and he's ranked number three. You know, so this is one of those mysterious, you know, appearances by a undefeated or once beaten fighter who appears in the top five so that they can become a mandatory challenger. It's clear to me that BJ Flores is nothing more when it comes to fighting in the ring, nothing more than a fraud. He's looking to get an easy way to get a world title shot. The truth of the matter is if he would have fought Francisco Palacios, that was for a title. So what is it telling you? It's telling you that he's afraid to fight Francisco Palacios. That's what it's telling you. You know, are you going to tell me that he's getting more money to fight Nuri Sefuri than he is to fight Francisco Palacios in Germany? Come on, man. Come on. He's a fraud. The second part of his question was about Pacquiao's health, and now he's going to fight a young hard hitter. You know, Pacquiao claims he's fine. You know, would you expect anything else from Manny Pacquiao? That's his style. We're not talking about Floyd. We're talking about Manny. You know what? I don't have a problem with him fighting Alvarado. It's either he walk away from the sport or he fights the level of fighters he always has. And Alvarado's one of those guys, you know, so... you know, we'll have to wait and see. Hopefully he's making the right decision. As far as Canelo and the barroom brawl, I don't care if he gets into a barroom brawl, but apparently his brother took the blame for him, and maybe he's worried about his image. I don't know. But could you imagine if they arrest him at the weigh-in or something crazy like that? But anyway, one last email here. T. Bruce says, people try to go to Floyd's body, but he will counter the crap out of you. If you dare, and don't forget that left glove tucked protecting the body. People go to his body all the time, and when they do land, he kind of walks through it. Has nothing to do with his footwork. You know what? Whatever. You know, all you Floyd Mayweather fans have him made out to be this superhero guy, and he's far from it. You know, the bottom line is he's a genius when it comes to calculating his risks, making the maximum reward. And, you know, if I had to put him in history right now, in boxing history, that's how I'd define him. You know, I wouldn't define him any other way. I wouldn't say he was the greatest fighter of all time because he's not. You know, he's the greatest fighter of this generation, maybe. Maybe. You know, I personally would rather put my money to see Manny Pacquiao. Not that I'm saying that Manny's a better fighter. It's just that he's more entertaining. And he fights, in my opinion, tougher opposition. Now, with that said, Floyd has some great comments here that I want to share with you guys. But that's going to have to wait. We're going to do a break. I got some news. I got some quick picks I'm going to do. All of that stuff is coming up in less than two.
In the real world, life has its shares of trials and tribulations, but you don't have to face them alone. This is Patricia Campanaro of Campanaro and Tomkovich. If you are facing emotionally difficult family legal issues from divorce to child custody, reach out to the team that will dedicate themselves to fighting for you, the team of Campanaro and Tomkovich. With almost 30 years of experience handling divorce, child custody, legal guardianship, visitation, and other legal issues dealing with family concerns, we can help you resolve the problems you are facing with professionalism and care. Our supportive staff is always ready to assist you with any questions or concerns you may have. To find out more about Campanaro and Tomkovich, visit us at DuchessNYLaw.com or call us and speak to a member of our attentive staff at 845-221-4099. That's 845-221-4099. Don't be surprised at court with inexperienced representation. At Campanaro and Tomkovich, we have been helping our clients get the justice they deserve for almost 30 years, and we could do the same for you.
Now back to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. He may not have an Excellence in Broadcasting Award, but the night's still young.
And he's got martinis.
So you never know what may be by morning. It's Talkin' Boxing with Billy C.
Talkin' Boxing with Billy C.
The one, the only, Don King.
Makes me feel good, Billy, to have you, the number one show in the country, Talking Boxing with Billy. So I invite each and every American that's listening to this great show to tune in. Because we want you to be there with Billy and me.
Hey, Jimmy's coming down across the alleyway. Up on the boulevard like it's
And we're back. You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C Show. You're watching us on the Fight Now television channel. And if you're looking for some more info on the Fight Now television channel, all you got to do is visit their website, www.fightnow.com. That's all you got to do. There was a fight yesterday from the land down under. And a couple of light heavyweight results. Blake Caparillo, he won a unanimous 12-round decision over Jorge Rodriguez Oliveira, who was a pretty experienced fighter. Caparillo improves his 16-0 with a draw with six knockouts. Oliveira drops to 24-7. The way the judges scored it, 120 to 108 three times. So congratulations to Blake Caparillo. And the co-main event featured another light heavyweight, Robert Buridage, who improved to 18 wins, a loss, and a draw with 14 knockouts when he stopped Serge Yannick at 1 minute and 25 seconds of the eighth round. Yannick hit the canvas a couple of times before the official stoppage. Yannick drops to 15-3 with seven knockouts. Floyd Mayweather had an open workout yesterday, and you know, he actually said some things that I actually liked. You know, normally when I watch this guy, I just, my stomach turns and I just want to, you know, throw something at him. You know, I mean, he's just so annoying to me. You know, everything about him, his face, his just his smile, that fake smile, all his henchmen always laughing and laughing at his stupid jokes. And he's just a guy that just irks me to no end. You know, I'm just, he's just got money, he flaunts it. I'm jealous, you know. But yesterday during his workout, you know, he was quoted as saying some stuff, and I think it was like the first time I think I've ever heard anything that I actually believe that came out of his mouth. And it was actually human, what he said. And he wasn't actually, you know, making it like, you know, he thought that, you know, his crap doesn't stink. You know, I mean, let me give you a couple of quotes that he said. He goes, you know, when he was asked about, you know, his training and how's it going and all this stuff, he says, you focus on your job, you don't break your regimen, you don't change up, and don't worry about the media. That's how you stay on top of your game. I want to thank the fans and, of course, the media for lending its support to this event. I mean, that's not typical Floyd, and I love it. I wish Floyd always acted like this. If Floyd always acted like this, you know, I think he would actually be bigger than he is today. I don't know, man. I don't know. To me, that is nothing less than a respectful comment. You know, he's not... I can't say anything negative. I give him an attaboy, but it gets better. He says, I want to go out there on May 4th and give the fans what they want to see. Now, that's a subliminal message or a blunt message. The big knock on Floyd, and it comes from my own mouth, is that he's not exciting, that he fights cautious, that he handpicks his opponents and everything else. Well, the diehard Floyd Mayweather fans feel that he has handpicked an opponent in Rob de Goetz Guerrero. Nobody's given him much of a chance. But this statement tells me that Floyd is going to go out there and, bring it to the ghost. You know, that's what we want to see. We want to see Floyd engage. We want to see, how good are you, Floyd? I'm convinced we haven't seen the best Floyd. That's how good I think he might be. You know, but he hasn't shown us because he hasn't had to. He only fights as much as he has to win. And, you know, I think that this is a great statement. I'm excited. By reading this and hearing him say that, I'm excited. I'm excited about it because I know what the fans want to see. And he then uncharacteristically of Floyd, he actually gives kudos to the Ghost when he said, Robert the Ghost Guerrero moved to the front of the pack by dedicating himself to his craft, and we will once again do record-breaking numbers for this fight. Normally, he never gives his opponents credit. You know, and he's right. He's dead on with this statement, too. Robert de Goetz Guerrero, you know, 2 years ago, I was laughing. at him saying that he deserved the shot at Mayweather. I was laughing. We were giving his publicist all the credit because they built this whole thing up from nothing. But yet, he fought two brilliant fights that got him into this position. And Floyd is, again, dead nuts on. He moved himself to the head of the pack. You know, I think this is the very first time I've heard comments from Floyd Mayweather that I actually like. And I'm getting all teary-eyed just thinking about Floyd right now. Maybe I've been wrong about Floyd. Maybe that pill that Given Quality told me to take one a day ever since he started listening to the show. Maybe it's starting to wear on me. I don't know. But I give an attaboy to Floyd, acting like a man and a true sportsman, which is uncharacteristic of him. Couple of things real quick before we get into picking the fights. It was announced yesterday that Alexander Povetkin is going to be taking on Andre Warozik for giving him a shot at the regular WBA World Heavyweight title. Listen, man, I can't even follow this bouncing ball. Last I knew that the WBA was making, Vlad Klitschko and Povetkin do a purse bid for the mandatory title challenge, you know, but I guess that was for the super heavyweight title. And meanwhile, back at the ranch, Povetkin's like, whoa, man, you know, don't I get another tune-up? Don't I get another guy that we can pull in from out of nowhere? Some guy that is undefeated, that looks good on paper, that can be moved up in the rankings really quietly, like overnight. And then all of a sudden, when people say, who is this Warozik? You know, who is Warozik? You know, and they punch him up, and all of a sudden they're going to see, and he's ranked in the top five of the WBA heavyweights, never hearing about him before. Well, that's exactly what Povetkin did. May 17th is when that fight's going to be on. And, the other fight is another one that looks pretty good. As a matter of fact, I got to see Guillermo Jones recently. He looks like he's in good shape. He's going to be taking on Denis Ladebev for the Cruiserweight World title. So, and speaking of Guillermo Jones and his promoter, who's Don King, John Muscionis predicted this to me while I was in Florida. He says, if Ryan Coyne loses the fight last week, in which he did, Marcus Oliveira, he said, I guarantee you Don King will release him from his contract. And it was announced yesterday that Don King Productions has indeed released Ryan, the Irish Outlaw Coyne, of his contract. These two guys were filing lawsuits against each other, so it's all over. Ryan Coyne's free. Don King got rid of him. And, Ryan Coyne's going to try to do bigger and better things, so we'll see what happens there. In the cruiserweight division, Marco Captain Huck, we were mentioning him before, was announced yesterday out of Germany that he's extended his promotional deal with Sauerland Events. And it's going to run through 2014, which includes six fights. And the first fight is his next upcoming fight against Ola Afolobi. So, yesterday, they also had a press conference with Saul Alvarez and Austin Trout. And here's a couple of comments. Canelo Alvarez said, I just want to prove that I'm the best and I'm ready. I think he is by picking Austin Trout, and I respect him for it. He wanted Austin Trout. His management and his promoter, Golden Boy, did not want Canelo to fight Austin Trout. Canelo insisted upon it, and should he beat Austin Trout on Saturday night, I think we all got to give him a boatload of credit on that. Promoter Oscar De La Hoya said, no matter who wins, the public is the inevitable winner. He says, we just want a good, clean, fair fight. Sounds like a referee, but he's right. The public is the winner. It is going to be a good fight. But here's the comment of the day. You know, I was just saying that Floyd Mayweather, gave a manly comment, a comment that I respect. Well, here's a comment I don't respect, and it shows you how corrupt the WBC is. The WBC's president, Jose Suleiman, who likes to be referred to as Don Jose Suleiman, says this about the fight. Now, you would think that the WBC, who tries to separate themselves from boxing and tries to define themselves as boxing, and although I agree with a lot of things that they've done, some good things, For the most part, it's just, you know, they're in my opinion, they're living in a glass house throwing rocks, man. And he says this. Now, if this isn't showing favoritism, I don't know what is. He says, no matter what the press has to say, Canelo Alvarez is the absolute best champion. What the hell does that mean? You know, it means that he's not recognizing the WBA champion, and he's just recognizing Saul Alvarez as a champion. You know, these guys are more biased than Jack London was back in the day. It's terrible, terrible. It was also announced on one report yesterday that that Timothy Bradley was actually going to be the next opponent for Juan Manuel Marquez. But then Juan Manuel Marquez's, Timothy Bradley's manager, Cameron Duncan, said that fight is not happening. He said, I'm denying that report. He said, and I quote, we don't know anything about it. I know nothing about it. I know Monica, who's Timothy Bradley's wife, and Tim don't know a thing about it. He's made a comment on a telephone call yesterday. He said, I don't know where it's coming from. We haven't seen a contract or anything. So as far as we're concerned, not only is Marquez Bradley not taking place, it's certainly not taking place on September 14th. So we'll have to stay tuned for that one. And one last thing I want to mention real quick. Javier Fortuna, who I'm going to talk about here in a second, did not make weight yesterday when he was making a defense of his world interim featherweight title, which is kind of crazy, these interim belts and how we're regarded on them and everything else. Miguel Samaduo is the guy who was fighting him. He did make weight. So here's the thing. If Samaduo wins the fight, he wins the belt. If Fortuna wins the fight, the belt is vacated. So, you know, one of these deals about, you know, fighters not preparing and being ready for a contracted weight, it's not, I think it's unforgivable, to be honest with you. He was forfeited $1,000. What made it even worse, now I like Samson Lukowicz. He's a promoter, manager, all that stuff. But he was making excuses after the fight. He says, the training camp didn't go well. He said, you know, his regular trainer wasn't around. He had to train with somebody else. The conditions were bad, blah, 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 blah. Hey, man, you don't make excuses. You know, take him out of the training camp. You know, make him go with his trainer. I don't know. You don't make excuses for coming in overweight. I'm sorry. You just don't. You know, so I don't care. You know, now you're blaming the trainer. So, so that's that. All right, let's talk about these fights. I do have some other stuff to talk about, but we don't have time. We'll get into it on Monday. All right, so we got some fights. Unfortunately, I don't have all of the recs in front of me. So I'm only going to do the first three on our picks. Now, we have 11 plays this week, so I'll give you the winners. But I want to make some comments about the first three fights because I was able to do the research and get some notes and stuff on these guys. Robinson Castellanos against Celestino Caballero. Celestino Caballero is a former junior featherweight and featherweight champion. He didn't lose the title in the ring. He gave up his title. If you recall, it was a big pissing contest between him and the WBA. He hasn't fought in over a year, 16 months. He's 37 years old, so the computer doesn't rank him. He's 5'11", freakishly tall for a featherweight. He's got a 73.5-inch reach, lots of experience, 273 rounds as a pro with a 58% knockout ratio. He's 37. His two fights with Jonathan Barros were pretty good ones, both of them. They split. He lost one and won one. He's also lost to Jason Litzau, which was a really good fight. He exposed Steve Molitor in 2008. He fought a tough Jeffrey Mathibula, and he's got some wins against Francisco Leal and Daud Yordan, and then, of course, the fights I mentioned. Now, he steps in with Robinson Castellanos, who's a former or current champion. Now, we're not sure on this because how do we look at the interim or silver champions? On paper, it shows that he won the WBC Silver Interim World Title, which silver is their version of interim world title, on April 2nd in 2011 when he beat Alberto Garza. He defended it five more times, three of which were by knockout. And then, again, somehow the title becomes mysteriously vacant prior to his fight with Edgar Ramirez. Now, whether it was a weight issue or not, I don't know. But he gets a shot at Edgar Ramirez once again for the vacant silver title, even though he had it under, even though he won it for those 2 years prior. He won it again, so to speak, against Edgar Ramirez in his last fight. That was in January. He's ranked number 10 in the featherweights. He's got a record of 17 wins, 9 losses, 11 of his wins coming by knockout. And he's got 166 rounds as a pro with a 42% knockout ratio. He steps in with Caballero, Celestino Caballero, who I think is going to win the fight. I think he's, despite Robinson Castellanos being ranked as high as he is by the computer, I'm not giving him much of a chance. The rest of the fights go as this. Scott Harrison, a young fighter, they call him the Real McCoy. I'm sorry, he's an older fighter. They call him the Real McCoy. He did some time, as my friends used to say. He went to college in 2006. He went to jail. You know, he did his time. He got out. He fought twice in 2012, coming back. He's 35 years old right now. The lightweight division has him ranked at number 201 as far as the computer rankings. 215 rounds as a pro with a 48% knockout ratio. Is a former world featherweight champion. Never lost his title in the ring. He won his title against Julio Pablo Chacon and even had wins against Wayne Pocket Rocket McCullough. He lost to Manuel Medina but then regained his title in 2003. Had some decent wins. His two fights since he got out of jail against decent opposition but not to where he is. Or where he was. Now he steps in the ring with Liam Walsh, who's the European lightweight champ. He's ranked at number 76 in the super featherweight division. He's 13-0 with 10 knockouts. He's only 26 years old. His two biggest fights really are his last two fights. He beat Domencio Urbano and Paul Appleby. He knocked out Urbano and he also made Paul Appleby retire on a stool. So the last two fights really are his two biggest fights of his career. He did have two good wins against John Kayes and Maxwell Akueyu. I think he's by far stepping into the lion's den when he takes on Scott Harrison. What does it all mean? It means I'm picking the younger kid. I think Scott Harrison may be the better fighter, but I'm picking the younger fighter in this one. I'm going to fly through the rest because of two reasons. Number one, we're running out of time. And number two, for some reason, the BoxRec website was down yesterday when I was trying to, you know, normally my thing is I print out the BoxRecs and then I, you know, further my research on each fighter and then make notes on the BoxRec itself. So the BoxRec printout. So I wasn't able to do that. So rather than spend a lot more time, I basically have my picks, and I'm going to give you the picks and why I'm going to pick them. In the third fight of our 11, Andres Gutierrez is going up against Salvador Sanchez II. Salvador Sanchez II against Andres Gutierrez is actually a pretty evenly matched fight on paper. They both have fought similar opposition and beat similar opposition and lost to the similar opposition. The thing is that I don't know much about Gutierrez, but I do know quite a bit about Salvador Sanchez Jr. Or Salvador Sanchez II. He's not even the junior. This kid is not good at all. The one thing I do know about Gutierrez is that he's got some pop. I don't care if you're knocking out your sister, if you got mostly knockouts of your fights, which he does. And the fact that Salvador Sanchez doesn't have that knockout power, and from what I've seen him fight several times, his skill sets are far and few in between. As a result, I think Gutierrez is the better fighter, even though he's not the favorite in this fight. I'm picking Andres Gutierrez against Salvador Sanchez II. In the next fight, similar to Marty's thought process, Emmanuel Larte going up against Jonathan Batista. Batista is the guy that everybody's trying to take a look at. Dominican fighter, you know, I kind of compare him to Thomas Delorme, you know, a guy that looks really good against marginal opposition, but when you step in with a tough guy, maybe things don't turn out as well. And Emmanuel Larte is a tough guy. Yes, he's a little older, but he is a tough guy. I'm picking Emmanuel Larte to beat Jonathan Batista. In another fight that's kind of evenly matched, John The Rock Jackson against Saraceno Fort. This was a tough one for me. They're both very similar in records and everything else. It's a coin flip, honestly. And when I flipped the coin, John Jackson came up. So I'm picking John Jackson in what I think is going to be an entertaining fight on ESPN. It's a triple header. So another fight I'm picking is Daniel Martz going up against Joshua Tuft. Both of these guys are undefeated heavyweights, but both of them are running that South circuit, and it's more like really not even South-South, not even like Florida-South, not like Georgia-South. I'm talking West Virginia-South. You know, this is another one of those tough ones. Yeah, they're both undefeated. Yeah, they both have impressive records, but who have they fought combined? Nobody. So it's another coin flip for me. And honestly, I'm picking Daniel Martz. I think he's from West Virginia. The fight's in West Virginia. I think he's going to get the edge. I'm picking Martz over Tuft, who has just as good of a chance as anyone else. Victor Terrazas against Christian Mahares. Terrazas is a young fighter, up and coming. But Mahares is a former champion. Yeah, he had a bad spell there, but he's turned it around. And like Marty says, you know, he's a slick fighter. Yeah, he's a little old. But I think he's similar to some other older fighters that find a second wind and use their experience that they gained as a younger fighter and, you know, keep their career alive. And because of that, I, too, am picking Christian Mahares like Marty. The Jason Fortuna against Miguel Zamudio fight. You know what? I like Zamudio, but I think Fortuna has got a lot to prove. He came in overweight. Now, the worst thing he could do is lose the fight, too. I don't think it's going to happen. I'm picking Javier Fortuna. The next fight is coming at us from overseas. Well, depending upon where you're watching us or listening to us from, you might be overseas, and I'm talking to you from overseas. But England, Nathan Cleverley going up against Robin Krasniqi. Now, as I've been telling you, Robin Krasniqi is working with my man, Torsten Kanzmeier, who helped Robert Stiglitz beat Arthur Abraham. Marty made some great points. The thing about Torsten is that not only does he teach more power, but it is a lot about mental. So, therefore, he's going to have Robin Krasniqi believing that he's got the power. I just don't know if it's enough to stop Nathan Cleverley. Nathan Cleverley's got a lot on the line. He's ready to bust into the U.S. scene here. He needs an impressive win here, and that'll catapult him over here. He is a champion. I think he's going to retain his title. I'm picking Nathan Cleverley against my man's Krasniqi. The next fight is happening on Saturday afternoon. I can't wait for that. Tyson Fury against Steve USS Cunningham. Steve USS Cunningham is a good fighter. He's got some great counterpunching ability. He's got some deceiving hand speed. I know a lot of people think his chin is chinny. It's questionable. But he displayed some pretty good whiskers against Tomas Adamak in his last fight. And they're all talking about the height disadvantage that Cunningham has against Fury. And I know on paper he certainly does. But in every photo I've looked at, it doesn't look like Tyson Fury is that big, that much bigger than Cunningham height-wise. But nonetheless, I think Cunningham's days are way over. I don't even think he's as good as his accomplishments were. Tyson Fury, on the other hand, I think is getting better and better. He's a big guy at 6'9". I think he is possibly the future of the heavyweight division, and I think this is a great test for him. It's not a layup fight for Tyson Fury, but should he win, it's going to be impressive. I'm picking Tyson Fury to win the fight. And finally, the fight of the weekend, really, Austin Trout goes up against Canelo Alvarez. Canelo Alvarez is a tough fighter. There's no doubt about it. He's well-regarded. He's possibly the next biggest star in the sport. I give him a lot of kudos for fighting Austin Trout. I just think Austin Trout is a better fighter, and I think that he's going to beat Canelo. and I'm picking Austin Trout. So in no particular order, I'm picking Javier Fortuna over Miguel Zamudio, Tyson Fury over Steve Cunningham, Nathan Cleverley over Robin Krasniqi, Austin Trout over Canelo Alvarez, Christian Mahrez over Victor Terrazas, Daniel Martz over Joshua Tuft, John Jackson over Cerecino Fort, Emmanuel Larte against Jonathan Bautista, Andreas Gutierrez over Salvador Sanchez, Liam Walsh over Scott Harrison, and Celestino Caballero over Robinson Castellanos. Good luck to everybody that's involved in our challenge. And if you want to get involved with the challenge, just email me, Billy at TalkinBoxing, TalkinBoxing.com.
Wake up. It's time for the...
It's too early
for a trivia question.
Question.
Today's It's Too Early for a Trivia Question. Question is, what world champion suffered the most consecutive knockout or TKO defeats? What former world champion suffered the most knockout or TKO defeats? If you know this answer, email me, Billy at TalkinBoxing, TalkinBoxing.com. Good luck to everybody there.
This day in boxing history.
And finally, this day in boxing history is being brought to us by Campanaro and Tomkovich. If you're looking for a lawyer, use the ones that keep my ass out of trouble. That is Campanaro and Tomkovich. Give them a call today, 845-221-4099, 845-221-4099. On this day, April 19th in 2002, seems like yesterday, but it was 11 years ago, Johnny Bredahl knocks out Eddie Moya in the ninth round to win the WBA World Bantamweight title, and that took place on this day, April 19th. In 2002 in Copenhagen, Denmark. Hey, man, that concludes our show for today. Make sure you enjoy all the fights this weekend. I do have one other thing to say. Make sure you tune in Monday morning, same bat time, same bat channel, the Fight Now channel. Call your local television provider and tell them you want the Fight Now channel added to your sports channel lineup. It's that simple. Pick up the phone and call. Only information about the channel can be found on our website, www.fightnow.com. See you all Monday. Ciao, baby.